Last time on the Vintage Collector, I took my first steps into Apple's original UNIX, AUX, a System 5-based OS fused with the classic Macintosh interface. It required very specific hardware, a Motorola 68K CPU with MMU and FPU, and ideally 16 MB of RAM to run the final 3.0 release. But since this SE30 only has 8 MB, I went with version 2.0 instead. Now that AUX is finally up and running, it's time to explore application compatibility, Apple's unique take on making the UNIX shell accessible for GUI-first users, how to recover from a nasty bootang using single-user mode, and how to build a multi-boot setup between System 6, System 7, and AUX. Under the dust, there's history waiting to boot. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. Looking around AUX, the GUI of course is all Mac. And yes, you can actually run any compatible Macintosh application, for example, Claris Works, as I had installed it on the Macintosh partition. Now, speaking of application compatibility, not all programs go well with AUX in general and AUX 2.0 in particular. It was better in terms of application support than its predecessor, but less capable than AUX 3.0. While the latter build on System 7 foundations, AUX 2.0 can practically only run applications compatible with System 6 and only if they're well behaved. That means only use the Macintosh Toolbox API and no direct hardware access. And while some programs bail with a specific error message, others may simply crash or lock up the entire system, as seen here in the example of Adobe Photoshop. For that alone, it would have been better to look into AUX 3.0 since it had broader application compatibility. Looking at the root file system, it certainly looks familiar enough if you know Unix systems. The About dialog reveals that we're basically on the same level of the native system software. What's interesting is that it shows the system and finder processes and the command shell process. The last one gives you the usual CLI, running /bin/sh as the shell. What struck me at first is that the PS command doesn't list the system and finder processes. Somehow, I was expecting to see those. Then I found out that those aren't actual Unix processes. They run internally as part of the Macintosh compatibility layer. And that layer is a real Unix process, typically /mac/bin/mac32, which provides the finder and the environment needed for Mac applications. Interestingly, there are actually two versions of that layer. /mac/bin/mac32 is the default 32-bit environment. But if you place a .mac24 file in your home directory, AUX will instead launch /mac/bin/mac24, a 24-bit compatible environment. Besides that, the shell provides everything you'd expect. But AUX goes far beyond that. If you look at the root file system, you'll find a folder named Useful Commands. And this one contains some aliases to well-known Unix commands with annotations in brackets.
Okay, extra file names to make it clear what things like chmod and grep mean.
This ties directly into COMMANDO, a GUI extension that provides parameterization forms for those commands. This way, they can be used directly from the graphical environment without having to memorize the CLI options yourself. Of course, the traditional Unix man pages still exist. so it's more a feature for users who aren't so familiar with the shell. What's particularly interesting is that you can also call up those special aliases directly from the shell without bringing up that graphical options dialog. On the other hand, the graphical options dialog isn't restricted to just the binaries in the useful commands folder either. You can run literally any standard binary, for example /bin/printenv, and the dialog will open for you as well. I think this is a pretty neat feature in terms of usability. Having a UNIX system at your fingertips, maybe you'd hope to access the Macintosh partition from within the shell, right? Nope, that doesn't work. The mount command doesn't show it, just the root file system. And according to the AUX FAQ, this is a known limitation. I assume the Macintosh partition only appears on the desktop as part of the aforementioned Mac32 emulation layer and therefore is only available within that compatibility environment, but not the real UNIX environment. Of course, AUX also includes an X11 display server named MacX. It's located at /mac/macx and also comes with some X11 programs like the calculator. Said that, it probably supports remote network displays as that's a common X11 feature and the display variable is, as expected, set on the shell. But I didn't invest any time in testing it over a network, so I'll just leave it open. We didn't talk about networking yet, and yes, AUX does have networking support. That's also one of the reasons I crammed in this Asante Ethercon adapter in the previous episode, since this one is said to be AUX compatible. By default, networking is disabled, but using the new config command, you can instruct AUX to rebuild a custom kernel with network support enabled. So I ran new config with the arguments AppleTalk and BNet to enable AppleTalk anti-Berkeley networking, which includes TCP/IP. I also tossed in NFS for NFS support and the AE6 driver for the network card. Plus, just for fun, the SND sound driver as well. Obviously, the sequence of arguments seems to matter, so I had to shuffle things around a bit to make the kernel compile, but anyway. As part of the new config process, I was prompted for basic network setup, hostname, domain name and IP configuration. And it could have all gone so well. Wouldn't the machine suddenly lock up during reboot just as it started initializing background services? Whatever that meant. It took me a while to figure out that you could click on that tiny icon up there to reveal the boot messages. Although, they were not particularly meaningful, except for telling me that it stuck when starting the init routing daemon. So while I was reading through that old AUX documentation, I noted in.routed implements the routing information protocol and follows the logic of broadcasting into the network to find suitable gateways. Now, in modern IP networks, no RIP instances exist, and in.routed seems to wait endlessly at this point as there's nothing there to respond. I found one reference somewhere that it would eventually timeout, but apparently it didn't for me and kept stuck even after 1 hour. The obvious thing for now was to disable in.routed and come back to a working AUX system. But how?
What a question, use single user mode.
Easier said than done. Even when going through the launch command, I see no direct way to interrupt or to get some kind of interactive prompt. While there is some configurable settings for the launcher, it doesn't provide for much, except enabling automatic or manual startup. Still, no way to provide something like a dash S or whatever to init to force a single user root shell. Also, the admin guides were not particularly useful. Even so, it mentioned single user mode here and there, it didn't say how to enable it. I guess it was assumed that people running AUX were familiar with System 5 and thus knew things. Eventually, I found out that those files located in the bin directory on the Macintosh partition are actually very meaningful to have. There's tools like NewFS, FSCK, TAR, RM, CP, and others. And in fact, when running them from the system software, they fire up into a very minimized root shell right away. This allowed me to take a copy of the /etc/init tab and edit the original file to enforce single user mode. It isn't a fully functional terminal, so I could only use ed instead of vi, but it was a start. This allowed me to change the init default from run level 2 to run level S, which would drop me to the shell on the next regular startup. Once I had access again to a functional terminal, I could figure out how to configure in.routed to use static remote gateways in /etc/gateways and overcome that annoying startup delay. With that sorted, I did some tests, including some FTP transfers, which worked all fine through the CLI. Even though I noted already not all applications were compatible to AUX, I then gave it a shot to run fetch, which seemed to work at first, but just bailed without errors when connecting to an FTP server. No surprise here, as I had somewhat expected that already.
The boot manager! I want to know about the boot manager now!
Oh, I almost forgot about it. Yes, there is no boot manager on classic Macs. Closest is the startup disk control panel on the system software. And even so, I used a separate System 6 partition in the beginning, I eventually moved everything over to the original Macintosh partition to have System 6 and System 7 coexist in there. For that, I installed System Picker. It's not really a boot manager on its own either. What it can do is to bless and unbless system folders, essentially facilitating the switching between different versions of the system software. You must still run it when the OS has already started up, and while having separate OS partition is better from a segregation point of view, System Picker supports multiple OSs from the same partition and was better appealing to me. That's why I eventually renamed the System 6 folder, so it can easily coexist on the original Macintosh partition with the System 7 folder, and I copied it over. That's one thing I definitely love about this classic system software. No sys command is needed. Copying the system folder is enough. That simple. By 1996, AUX quietly faded into obscurity, but Apple wasn't done with Unix just yet. They took another short-lived detour, this time in partnership with IBM, licensing AIX to run on their high-end Apple network servers. While AUX lasted from 1988 to 1995, the AIX on Apple venture barely made it 2 years before being discontinued. And then came the turning point. Apple acquired Next, and with it, Next Step, a modern, object-oriented Unix-based OS. This would soon evolve into macOS X, laying the foundation for everything macOS has become today. So in that end, what began as a "we need Unix to stay in the game" initiative gradually matured into full commitment. Apple didn't just adopt Unix, they rebuilt their entire operating system around it. But the AUX story doesn't quite end there. There was also Mac AE, Apple's Unix application environment, a rare compatibility layer that allowed running Macintosh applications on Solaris and HP Unix systems. How about you? Did you ever use AUX back in the day? Was it deployed at your school or workplace, or were you bold enough to run it at home? Drop your memories and stories in the comments. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.